Niggas used to be like, suck, and try to sweat a nigga like the lip. For no reason at all, I can't recall if niggas rolling C's in my face. Down the hall, I'm kicking it in the back of the school, eating chicken at 3. Wondering why everybody always picking on me. I tried to talk and tell them, chill, I did nothing to deserve this. But when it didn't work, I wasn't scared, just real nervous and unprepared to deal with scrapping, no doubt. My pappy never told me how to knock a nigga out, but now in 95, I'm a survivor, a man on my own. Fuck around with fat lip, yeah, she get blown. I'm not trying to show no macho is shown, but when it's on, then it's on.
Can't keep running away. Can't keep running away. time. And every man's life when he's gotta handle shit up on his own. Can't depend on friends to help you in a squeeze, please. They got problems of their own. Double the count on seven chicken shits. Don't get to heaven, chill. Hey guys, good morning. Thank you very much for coming. It's an honor and pleasure to have Dan today. Before I'll introduce him to you, and hopefully you will have some tangible insights from this event, I just want to explain how important that is for us and why are we doing that. So. We have recently translated the book of the friend of Dan, David Kelly, called Creative Confidence into Ukrainian, which I encourage you to read. And this book is fundamental because I think what ultimately Dan and David are doing in Stanford at D School is building the proper culture. So not many of us know, but based on different statistics, the Stanford graduates, they generate over $1 trillion of new economic value per year. So it doesn't matter what their actual number is, but it goes without saying that they're doing an amazing job. So the question is, how do they do that? What is the secret sauce of that? And in my opinion, and I've been thinking about that for quite a long and discussing with lots of entrepreneurs, is the culture. I mean, you have to be smart and you have to know a lot of things, but culture is actually what influences our behavior, and behavior is what influences our decisions, and this is ultimately what allows us to do some particular products or innovations or something, some compatible products, whatever. So what Dan is doing today is very important because he's explaining what is that culture look like, how does it look like, what is special about. So when you will have this meetup with Dan, I really encourage you to compare the culture of the Stanford and the California and Silicon Valley specifically with how things are done here in Ukraine. And we also preach the design thinking ourselves. We've recently started the Zeo Lab team, which is exploring the new product, and it's a really great human-centered methodology where you, instead of just doing some sort of idea, you explore the human needs, you work on the challenge, and then you try to come up with an actual product that solves that problem. This is also something not common at all here. And this is actually the start of the month of the design thinking here in Ukraine. So we're going to have, during the next 30 days, we're going to have a couple more events specifically dedicated for engineering design from different various speakers, which I also encourage you to check out. And today, it's a pleasure to invite on the stage Dan, someone who knows about design thinking and creative confidence as no one else. Dan, thank you very much. The stage is yours.
My pleasure. Thank you. Thank you. You are all creative geniuses. Your ability to come up with novel solutions to unique challenges on the fly and under pressure is virtually infinite. Your capacity for creative thinking has no limit. I have a metaphor that I think about with this, and it comes from my childhood. When I was little, I used to play a game. I don't know if you've heard of this game. It was called Dungeons and Dragons. Does anyone know that game? Oh, good. Oh, good. My people. Dungeons and Dragons is an amazing role-playing game of the imagination where you go on adventures in imaginary dungeons and you search for treasure. And so I think of creativity as being like having a magical treasure chest that you each have. And anytime you need a new idea, all you have to do is reach inside your magical treasure chest and it is full. It is overflowing with resources and treasures, with gems and jewels and amulets and goblets and magic elixirs. Whatever you need in the moment, it's right there. And every time you go to it, it's full again. The problem is, if you're like most of us, myself included, sometimes you find that your magic creative treasure chest is locked. When you need it, you can't open it. In fact, it gets worse. Your treasure chest may actually be buried in a dungeon that's underneath a mountain, maybe even an active volcano. And when you really need it, you find that your creative treasure chest is guarded by a fierce dragon. And you know the feeling. You know that moment when you're under pressure and you know, I need a creative idea right now. And you go to reach for a creative idea, and instead of feeling like you can share the idea, you feel the hot shame or embarrassment of the possibility of saying something that is judged or criticized. And that hot shame, I think, is the dragon breathing on you. And so you decide, you know what? I'm not going to go to my creative treasure chest. I'm just going to do the normal thing, the regular thing, the thing we know already works, and we'll be safe. I think that's okay. My job, and I get to do this all over the world, really, is to help you figure out how to unlock your creative treasure chest, how to help you find where it's buried. And I'm never gonna help you slay the dragon. I don't think we should slay the dragon. I think we probably need that dragon for some reason. But I want to help you befriend the dragon, or at least distract her for a little while you get at your treasure chest. So my plan today is to share with you some of those techniques, how to get at your creativity when it feels like it's hidden. I also want to give you a little bit of the history of creative education at Stanford, because I think that it's a relevant and interesting story how we have gotten to this incredible creative culture and entrepreneurial spirit that exists right there in Silicon Valley right now. And along the way, I want to have you guys actually do some exercises. So I love talking, but it won't be very valuable for you unless you actually do it and try it. So during the course of about a little bit more than an hour, I'm going to talk, I'm going to have you play some games, and then give you a chance to ask me any questions and see how it goes. I have a specific plan for the hour, and hopefully we will get knocked off of my plan and I'll actually be able to improvise along the way. How does all that sound to you? Is this good? We're okay to go? All right, excellent. Thank you so much, by the way, for taking some time this weekend to come here and explore these ideas. I've been now in Kiev only for a few days, and I'm blown away. I'm blown away by the energy and spirit, by the bright-eyed eagerness and excitement, and as some people have described it to me, a hunger for these ideas right here, right now. It's really compelling and exciting for me to share with a group like you. Quick background. I did a little bit of research. I've been at Stanford for a while myself. I went there as a student almost 30 years ago. But the history of creative education at Stanford goes back about 60 years. Sometime around the 1950s, there was a professor that we invited to join the Stanford faculty. He was teaching at MIT. And in Boston. He was a very creative professor. He was an engineering professor named John Arnold. And he taught a famous class. It was in magazine articles in the United States as being a breakthrough in education. It was very bizarre. He taught a class called Creative Engineering. So he was an engineering instructor who realized that you can teach creativity through steps like an engineering process. And you can teach it to engineers and that they would embrace these ideas as long as you didn't give them problems that had an answer. You had to give open challenges, like real world challenges. But he did something really dramatic. His class started with a big project called the Arcturus IV project. And Arcturus IV told the students when they walked into the classroom, they said, This class now takes place in the future, and intergalactic space travel is common, and your job is to design products for the Methanians, which is a race of bird-like creatures that live on the fourth planet of the Arcturus star system. The Methenians are 3 meters tall. They have claws for hands, and they have 3 eyes, and the third eye can see X-rays. They are also very, very susceptible to sales pitches. They created all sorts of supporting material. They hired science fiction writers, and they created documents that came from this future system. And the students had to learn about what the Methenians were like so they could design products for these aliens. Well, what John Arnold was really doing was he was creating what we call now user-centered design. The designers were not designing for themselves. They weren't even designing for humans. They had to develop empathy for another creature in another context, and it opened up their creative possibilities. When John Arnold came to Stanford, he started teaching in the engineering program, and he worked with other teachers like Jim Adams and Bob McKim, who then, when John Arnold died, way too young in his 50s, his legacy was carried on by that next layer of teachers. Those teachers became the mentors of David Kelly, the author of Creative Confidence. And so David has been carrying on their legacy of teaching creativity to engineers in new and inventive and creative ways. When I got to Stanford about 30 years ago, I studied theater. I took classes in the drama department in improvisation. My teacher was named Patricia Ryan Madsen, and she was a master teacher at teaching people how to get up on stage and make up a play without a script. Has anyone ever seen improv before? Sometimes people have seen the show Whose Line Is It Anyway, which is out of the UK, and then it came to America. Improv is a great art form. There's a lot of pressure on an improv actor. They have to get up on stage, and they get a suggestion from the audience, and then they make up a story. Well, Patricia was a master at teaching this. And what she did was she made it safe for us to take risks. I think that's the key to all of this. The D School is carrying on her legacy. Along with David Kelly and the other early teachers in the D School, what they did was they decided, maybe a little bit more than, it was 12 years ago or so, in 2005, they decided to try some experiments in how do we teach creativity to radically different interdisciplinary teams. The challenges that the world faces right now are too complicated to be solved by just one industry or one discipline. We need to bring business and engineering and sociology and the arts in to solve all of our sticky problems. So we started doing experiments, trying out different class techniques, trying out different models for bringing students in, for partnering with industry and people outside of the university to do world projects. That legacy started with John Arnold. When he came to Stanford, he was in the School of Engineering, and he had an appointment in the business school. Stanford was on the cutting edge of creating relationships between industry and government. That was essential for forming what is now Silicon Valley. The idea of having people learn at Stanford and then go off and start a company is still very, very present there. One of my colleagues had a student not very long ago who had his assignment was to do something with photos and how you store photos. That was the assignment in the class. And he said, oh, I've got a creative idea. What if instead of storing them, we erased the photos? And he did that for a little while, and he made an app, and within 2 years, he was turning down a $3 billion offer from Facebook, and that's now Snapchat. And that was just a little idea, play around with it, see how it goes, and then iterate as you find out how the market responds. So these ideas we're running with right now. We're playing with and exploring and testing, and we're always iterating them. We're always changing. The work that I do starts in improvisational theater, but I now also am a lecturer in the business school. I teach classes at the D School. I teach in departments all over the university, and I get to travel around the world. The key things that I'm showing really started with Patricia Ryan Madsen. It's creating a safe place to take risks. The other thing that's of value in this work, I know, is forming connections with other people. This is not a solo activity. Creativity is not an individual thing. It is a group thing. And more important than anything is how you connect with people. Now, I understand that some of you know some of you in the room, right? Maybe you know one, but you don't all know each other. This is not a group that travels around together. Is that true? Okay. But you are here today now for a reason. You are here to connect with each other, and there may be some partnerships that are formed, or friendships, or possibilities for new collaborations that are here in this room right now. So I want to take advantage of that possibility, the lucky happenstance that you're all with each other, and I'm going to give you a couple of exercises that show how people connect. So right now, I want you to find a partner, someone sitting near you who maybe you don't know, and teach them what your name is. Do a name tag introduction. Say, this is my name, this is where I work, or this is where I'm from. Just a quick introduction. Everyone needs one partner. So if you don't have a partner, stand up and find someone else is standing up, and you may move to go find that partner. Do you have a partner? If I don't find you another partner, will you come help me demonstrate on stage? It's very low key. I'll keep it very safe and easy. Okay, great. Thank you. All right, good. I want everybody, can I have your attention? Everybody right now, can you, I just want to see that you have your partner. Can you do like a high five with your partner so I can see that you've got a partner? Everyone do a quick high five with your partner. And is there anyone who doesn't have a partner? Because I have, there's someone without a partner up front right here who could use a partner. Is there anyone who's still looking for a partner? Who, where? Back here? Oh, there's one. Why not, actually, oh good, come on up. Awesome. Hey, yeah, thank you. You guys introduce yourselves to each other. Yes. Yeah.
Well, hello. My name is Inga. I'm a web designer, and I'm here today to listen to
that. Awesome.
My name is Owen. I'm from Weave. I'm also a designer.
Yeah, well done. Great. Good. Thanks, you guys. How brave to have volunteered to come up. Now, this is the game. They're going to demonstrate this activity. This is what you're going to do with your partner. One of the ways that people connect is by working together on a task and being successful. You know that when you're successful, when you feel a connection with your partner, as long as you're not arguing over who gets credit for the win. All right, so I'm going to give you a really simple task. You're going to count to three. But you will start, you will say one, and then you will say two, and then you'll say three. Let's try it.
One, two, three.
Success. Give a high five. Very nice. Yeah, good. Right on. It also helps for them to celebrate success. It's a good way to indicate, like, we did it, we succeeded, and we have a celebration. This is a very small success, so they had a very small celebration. but you might have noticed that Inga did twice as much work as Oleg. So we're going to balance that. You start this time.
One, two, three.
Good, success again. High five. Yeah, good. All right. You guys are going to do this in a moment, but I'm going to make a prediction. I'm going to make a guess. I'm going to assume that if you're here in this room today, that you're what we call a high achiever. You're someone who is probably not satisfied simply counting to three a couple of times. So the actual task is to do it over and over as fast as you can. And you're not even going to stop to celebrate until I say stop. So you're going to go one, two, three, one, two, three, until I say, okay, good, stop. And then you'll give a celebration. Can you show us that really quick? Good. All right. Good. Celebrate. Very nice. Yeah. All right. They were very good. So now you do it. This is very important. You're going to go as fast as you can, celebrate at the end. If you make a mistake, if you mess up in counting to three, nothing happens. All right. No penalty, no cost. No. You just start over. Go until I ring the bell. And then when I ring the bell, celebrate with your partner. Okay. Ready? Okay. You guys do it. I will. I will. I'll give them that. Is that okay? Is it too much to do? Okay. I will make cheek. But actually, if you mess up, it'll be good. It will be better if you mess up. Okay? Okay. Good. Good. I will hold the mic. Here, you guys come on up. It's Inga and Oleg. Am I right? Yeah. Good. Okay. Good. I'll hold it. I don't want them to hold it. Yeah, high five. All right, how did it go? Do you have success? Were you able to count to three at least a couple times? Okay, good. Who messed up? Raise your hand if you messed up. Look at that. Isn't that amazing? I love this exercise because it seems like everybody messes up at some point in counting to three. I used to tell people that messing up in this game was a sign of intelligence, but that's not true. That's not true. It's not related to intelligence at all. Everybody messes up. I'm actually really curious, what did you do when you messed up? You laughed and start again. That is good. That is very healthy. Laughing when you make a mistake is a healthy response when the stakes are so incredibly low. Low stakes, go ahead and laugh. What else did you do? Before you laughed, did you notice your body language, your facial expression, anything you did right before you laughed and started over? There's a tension. I want you all to notice this. I want you to notice your physiological response to failure and mistakes. I'm going to have you do it again. I'm going to make it harder because I want you to make... By the way, was there anyone who didn't mess up? Anyone did not make a mistake? Okay. This is an important concept around creativity. If you are not making mistakes, you are doing something wrong. So, if you haven't messed up yet, I want you to go faster and make sure that you mess up. In fact, I'm going to redefine the goal of this game. The goal of this game is not to succeed, it's to fail. The goal of the game is to mess up at some point. All right, so here, I'm going to make it harder, and these guys are going to demonstrate. So this time, you're going to still go 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, but you're not going to say one. Instead of saying the number one, you're going to clap. So it'll be clap, 2, 3, clap, 2, 3. Go ahead and try it. Good, just like that. Very nice. These guys are great at it. I want you to do it, and I want you to go so fast that you mess up sometimes. Okay, ready, go. All right, very good. Good. Sorry. All right, good. Good. Okay, we'll do it again with a little variation. Okay, but mess up. If you mess up, it's good. All right, good. How did that go? Yeah. So what did you notice in the messing up? Did you feel the tension when you make a mistake? What was the facial expressions that you made? What's that? Yeah, she did this squint. Sometimes we do a squint, or we cringe, or we flinch, or wince. I don't know, in English, all of these words have an in sound. Squint, cringe, flinch, wince, grimace. I don't know, in Ukrainian, do they have a similar sound? Can I hear some of those words? Can you translate some of those words? Skreveres. 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 I don't know, maybe. Yeah, yay. All right, here's the deal. I think that's. I think it's fine that we do that. That we tense up when we make a mistake. I think that we're doing it to protect ourselves. I have a theory that the reason we tense up when we make a mistake is because we're protecting ourselves against punishment that we think might be coming. Maybe it's not that someone's going to hit us. Maybe our punishment is that they'll criticize us or judge us. And so we tense up, which is fine. It's safe and healthy, but it's not resilient. It's not resourceful. It's not generative and innovative and creative and open. there's a different physicality that's needed when you're doing creative work. So this is the exercise. I'm going to have you do it again. And this time, when you mess up, I want you to do the exact opposite physicality. Rather than close off, I want you to open gloriously in a celebration. I want you to throw your hands in the air, big smile, wide open eyes, and I want you to celebrate in a celebratory way. I want you to say, ta-da! Everyone on the count of three, do that. Ready? One, two, three.
Ta-da!
Yeah, good. Over the top. If you don't feel celebratory, I want you to pretend that you are celebratory. It is a glorious moment when you've made a mistake. I want you to embrace it with the exact opposite physicality. But you guys are going to demonstrate, and hopefully you'll mess up so you can do a ta-da. We're going to make it harder in this round. It's a clap for one and a snap for two, and then you say three. Clap, snap, three. When you mess up, say ta-da. Show us what it looks like. Yeah, there it is. Yeah, great. Awesome. When we do this work, if somebody messes up and they're able to celebrate messing up, we cheer for them. That is a triumph. That is a great moment. So if someone throws their hands in the air, then we will cheer because they have just celebrated failure in a spectacular way. Try it yourselves. Clap, snap, three, ta-da. Go for it. All right, good. All right, we're almost done. Almost done with you guys. These guys are so good. Okay, how did it go? Were you able to celebrate failure? Yeah, I saw a lot of ta-das in the room. What did it feel like to celebrate failure? It's fun. What else? Give me some more words.
Unusual.
This is what I find when I share this with people. Usually the first answer when I say, how was that? People say, it was fun. It was great. It was liberating. It felt freeing. And then when I ask again, I say, what else? They say, weird. It was awkward. I think it should be both. This is a strange behavior. This is not trained. This is not your education and your experience growing up and becoming an adult was not learning to celebrate failure. So it should feel both liberating and awkward and strange and unusual. You're doing it right if you have both those feelings. Now, I'm going to have you do one more round. I don't know if you noticed in that last round, maybe there was a moment where your partner messed up. And maybe you noticed it before they noticed. And you were like, hey, you'd say ta-da right now. That's not totally fair. You guys are a team. You're a pair. And so in this round, I want you to assume that if your partner messed up, it was probably your fault. In fact, maybe you had messed up and they were just being polite and pretending to mess up so you wouldn't feel bad. If either of you mess up, you've both messed up. So I want you to celebrate and say ta-da. In this, both of you will celebrate. And then we're not going to go back afterwards and go, it's your fault. It doesn't matter. You both celebrate and then you start over. And in this round, a pause is a mistake. If you have to stop and think about what comes next, ta-da is what comes next. They're going to demonstrate. It's going to be, this is the last round, so you're going to actually have to do it standing up in a second because it's going to be clap for one, snap for two, and stomp your foot for three. And if you have to pause for a moment, then you both say ta-da. So let's see it. Go for it. Yeah, good, good. Awesome. Just like that. Give these guys a huge hand. Thank you. And give it a try. Give it a try yourselves. You guys play it. Try it out. Stand up. Everyone stand up. Clap, snap, stomp, ta-da.
Change the mic, please, because it is...
It's cutting out.
Yeah.
You just go there. All right. Give your partner a big high five. Give your partner a high five. Thanks, you guys. You can have a seat. I'm very excited to imagine that the two of them will be doing web design together and creating amazing things, a nice partnership. Here's my question. How do you feel about your partner right now? Awesome, right? This is what we figured out. People bond really nicely when they have success together. They bond even faster if they fail together. As long as you are failing without blame. When we blame each other for failure, then it poisons the bonding effect. But if you can fail cheerfully together without blame, you bond even closer. Think back on the people that you feel the tightest connection with. Some of them are ones that you went through very hard times together. It ends up being, it's a feature of human nature that we connect with people that we suffer with. Very important to keep in mind. I think there's a lot of benefits to failure and to mistakes. There's a lot of examples in the world of science, in industry, of breakthroughs that came from mistakes. Vulcanized rubber, apparently, was discovered by Charles Goodyear when he left rubber near the stove for too long and burned it. He figured out something brand new and started a tire company. 3M is it a company that there was a chemist there named Spencer Silver, and he was working on a very strong adhesive, and he failed, and he came up with a very not sticky adhesive, and they turned that into Post-it notes. It ended up being a great success. The product was absolutely successful. It was a failed adhesive. Sometimes I tell the story about sildenafil, which was a high blood pressure medication that that the pharmaceutical company felt was very promising, and they threw a lot of money into the development of it, and they went to human trials. Human trials are very expensive because you have to be very careful when you're actually trying your medicine out on real people. But they had subjects that they were testing how good this medicine was at hypertension, high blood pressure. And they started the trials, and after just a month or two, they realized they got the first data back, and they realized that it was a failure. It had no effect whatsoever on high blood pressure. And they canceled the study at a great cost. They had already invested a lot of money in research and development, and they canceled the study, and they recalled all the medicine that was still outstanding. But something interesting happened. None of the men in the study returned the pills. And they discovered Viagra. Sildenafil is the generic name for Viagra, which is now supposedly the most successful pharmaceutical product that human beings have ever created. It was a failure. It was a mistake. But mistakes are gifts. They're opportunities to discover something new. Failures are also opportunities to learn. In Silicon Valley, there's a rule of thumb for investors, for venture capitalists. They don't invest in a company that is led by someone who has not already had a failure. If you have failed in your company, that is a badge of honor. You are now someone who knows what that's like, and you have more experience, and you're a better bet for future companies. Failure along the way in design thinking helps us learn faster. One of the things that David Kelly always says is that the cost of failure at the beginning of a project is way smaller than it is later in the project. So get all your failures out early, dive in and make mistakes. Mistakes are gifts. It's a key component to all of this work. And I think it's the thing that gives us creative confidence. Is if it's not okay to make a mistake, then it's not okay to try. But if it's okay to make a mistake and we celebrate our failures, then we will dive in and we will discover stuff right away. What do you guys think of that idea? It's important. This is valuable. This is also useful for kids. There's a period where kids are fine making mistakes. There's a moment in their development where they learn not to make mistakes and that they're not supposed to, and they get very hard on themselves when they do. That is a critical period in their development. That is when education kills creativity. The moment when kids no longer think that they can make mistakes, we have to be very careful with those moments. That one is allowed to make mistakes. All right, I'm gonna show you some more techniques for creativity, but for this next one, I need you to find a new partner, a new opportunity to meet somebody and connect with them, and I'll show you a new way that people also form connections. So find a new partner, and you may actually move around. Find someone from a different row. That would be awesome. And some may be standing, and some may be sitting. All right. It's possible in this game to play with two people or with three people. So if you have a partner, look around and see if there's a lonely person who doesn't have a partner and invite them to join your group, because threes are okay also. So if you've got two, see if there's someone who needs to be welcomed in. All right. Inviting singles into your pair. Great. All right. Here's the exercise. This is an imagination exercise. And what I want you to pretend, this is all just pretend. What I want you to pretend is that you and your partner or partners have known each other for years. You go way back. You grew up together. Your families were friends. You went to school together. You lived together. You worked together at various jobs. You've traveled around the world and you've been on many adventures. You guys go way, way back. This game is called Remember That Time We. And the way it works is one of you, it doesn't matter who, will say, "Remember that time we," and then you could say whatever you want. You could say, "Remember that time we went skiing," or you could say, "Remember that time we went to the movies?" It doesn't matter what you say. It could be something exciting or boring. You could say, "Remember that time that we went to Starbucks?" You know, it doesn't matter. And then you're going to go back and forth remembering things about that event. But this is the rule. I want you to disagree about the details. Your partner remembers it a little bit differently than you do. All right. We're going to play for about a minute until I ring the bell. Ready? Go. All right, good. Stop right there. How was that? Were you able to talk about a fake memory and disagree about the details? Yeah. How did it go? It's fun. It's funny, right? It's fun creating this false, fake story. I'm curious about this. I've been playing this game for a little while now. I'm curious about how you disagreed about the details. It seems like there's actually a whole range of different ways to do it. What were the ways that you disagreed about the details? Anybody? Oh, and maybe if somebody wants to, sometimes we have a microphone to run around, but if you don't get there, I'll repeat what you say. What's a way that you disagreed about the details? Anybody?
Directly confronting and saying that no.
Right. Great. So directly confronting them and saying, "No, that's not right. We did something else." So someone say, "Hey, remember that time we went skiing?" And you could say, "No, we didn't go skiing. We went to the beach," right? We have a name for that. We call that blocking. We are blocking ideas. This comes from another one of my teachers. Actually, my mentor was Patricia Ryan Madsen, who wrote Improv Wisdom, but her mentor was Keith Johnstone, who wrote the book Impro. And Keith talks about blocking ideas as saying no to a creative idea. There's another way that people disagree about the details. If you didn't say flat out no, what did you do? I guess you're maybe not right. That's not quite right. Is there another way to put it? In my opinion, yeah, maybe that's true in your mind, but the way I remember it was a little different. Yeah. Is there another way that someone could describe how you disagreed about the details? Okay, but there's a yes, but yes, yes, we did go skiing, but we spent our whole time in the lodge. Yeah. When we say yes, but we are accepting part of the idea, but we are still blocking the idea. Yes, but is still a block. Now, Keith Johnstone in Impro, he talks about another way. Besides blocking ideas, the opposite of blocking ideas is to accept ideas. Not partially accept the ideas, wholeheartedly accept the ideas, and then add to it. So that's how we get the mantra, the creative collaboration mantra of, if it's not yes, but, what is it? Yes. It's yes and. So you're going to do it again with your partner. You're going to do one more round. You're going to start with a different memory. Oh, remember that time? It could be anything. Remember that time we dug a hole to the center of the earth? It doesn't matter what you say. Whatever your partner says, you will say yes and. You will accept the whole idea, and then you will add to it. I want you to be, you won't necessarily say yes, because that's a little bit formal. So you might say, your partner say, oh, remember that time we went skydiving? You go, oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. And your parachute didn't open. And then they'll go, oh, yeah, that's right. I had to grab onto you, and we did it together. Yeah. So every idea that your partner says, you'll get so excited that you'll go, oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. You'll make lots of noises of affirmation. And then you'll add to the idea. You will wholeheartedly accept your partner's idea. We're going to play it for a minute. Ready, go. All right, good. Give your partner another high five. Thank your partner for doing that. Great. So I want to reflect on that for a second. How did that round go? It was fun. It was awkward? Yeah. We get into some trouble when we accept all ideas. We go into some dangerous territory sometimes. Tell me more. How else did that feel? Compare it to the previous round. It felt smooth. What else? Freedom. There's more nonsense. There's more possibility for outrageous stuff. When we are accepting all offers, sometimes we leave reality. We leave the normal zone. This is the point that I want to make about yes and versus yes but. One thing that we know is that yes but is valuable. It's important. It's critical. We have to be able to think with a yes, but mindset. We have to critique things. We have to judge them. We have to determine priorities. We have to look at safety and practicality. Yes, but is very good for incremental improvements on our ideas. We are doing this. Yes, but what if we make this little change? What if we make this adjustment? Yes, but is critical. It's what you have been learning in all your training. It's what academia teaches. Yes, but. Yes, and is a different way of thinking. If you want to get a breakthrough idea, you have to play with yes and. And sometimes the breakthrough idea comes from the ideas that are outrageous, that are impossible, that are dangerous, that are that break the laws of the land and the laws of physics. But the breakthrough idea comes from scaling back an outrageous, impossible idea into reality, rather than incrementally improving what we already have. So playing yes and, playing like a child in this creative spirit, can take us to the new ideas. David Kelly talks about this all the time. At IDEO, they say there's a moment in the creative process where we want to play like children. Later, we'll bring the adults back into the room, and we'll sift through what ideas the kids came up with and see which ones are viable, which ones we can actually commit our resources to. But it's so important to be able to know where you are in the creative process and play yes and. It also, you have to let go of your ego in order to play a yes and. You may have been talking about things that you did in this imaginary world that you personally would never do. Did that happen? Yeah, you would never do. You would never be caught dead doing them. We are playing. It is imagination. You have to let go of your ego to get there. All right. So I'm making a little list of some of the ways that we bond, because I think this work is critical about forming connections with our partners. We're talking about creative collaboration as a mode for generating new ideas. We have to succeed together, we have to fail together, and we have to create together. I'm going to give you another thing that we do to form quick connections, rapid bonds. But you need to find a new partner, a different partner, someone somewhere else in the room. Do a quick name tag introduction. Go for it. All right, good. Here's what I want you to do with your partner. I want you to think about when you were a child, when you were little. I want you to think about how you liked to play when you were a kid. There's a book, one of my co-teachers at Stanford, who teaches a class in the D School called From Play to Innovation, is Dr. Stuart Brown. Dr. Brown wrote a book called Play. He founded the Institute for Play, and he did some research on how people played. And what he determined was everybody has their own unique play personality or their own play history. It was a way that you liked to play when you were a kid. And there are categories of play. And I'll name them now just to spark some ideas. This is not an extensive list, but it captures a lot of big ones. Some people like to play, Dr. Brown called them jokers. They love to make jokes. They were a class clown. They like to get people to laugh, do practical jokes, things like that. Some people were competitors. They love to do things that had a contest to it. That might mean playing sports, or it might mean playing chess, but they love to play games where there was a winner and a loser. Other people were kinesthetes. A kinesthete is someone who played physically in the world. That could be an athlete. It could be a dancer. It even could be an actor who loved creating characters with their body. Or you could be a storyteller. You love to create stories and in any form. Or maybe you were a collector. You love to collect things and sort them and capture all of them. Maybe you were a director. You love to orchestrate and organize the play among your friends. You may have been a combination of things. I realized when I read Dr. Brown's book that my play history, especially when I think about the brief window when I played Dungeons and Dragons, was storyteller-director. I love to create stories, and then I was a dungeon master, and I would bring my friends through these worlds, these experiences together. So storyteller, director. So I want you to take a 1 minute each right now. So I'll give you a total of 2 minutes to talk to your partner about your play history. What did you love to play when you were a kid? What categories did you think your play fell into? And then listen to theirs. And if you're curious, ask them questions about what they like to play. You might find that you had things in common, and you might find that you did things that were different from each other. So you get 2 minutes right now to chat with your partner about what you like to play when you were a kid. Thirty seconds left. All right, good. Now stay with your partner for a moment. Stay with your partner. I want to wrap that up, but I want to do this. I want you to think about, you were just talking about how you used to play as a kid. I want you to think of a specific toy or game that you used to play, maybe one that you just talked about. And then I want you to think about a noise or a sound that you associate with playing that toy or game. So it might be a sound that the toy made. You know, I used to play the game Operation. Do you guys know this game? Where you try to, and so a sound I would associate with Operation is when you mess up and it goes, right? Or if I thought about playing hide and seek, there's a moment in hide and seek when you're calling everyone to come back out and you say, Ollie Ollie Oxen Free. I don't know if that's, maybe that's just my, something like that. So I want you to think of a toy or game and then think about a sound or a noise that either the toy made or that you used to make when you played it. Think of that sound. And on the count of three, I want you to look your partner in the eye or your partners, and all at once, I want you to make your sound together. Make your own sound. Ready? Look at your partner. One, two, three. All right, good. And before we do the next thing, I want you to go find your ta-da partner and do a quick ta-da with your ta-da partner. Do you remember the one you did the 1, 2, 3? Do ta-da with your old ta-da partner and then find a brand new partner. Ta-da! And then find a new partner. Find a brand new partner, someone new to work with. And three is okay. Three is okay. Three is okay. All right. You're finding a new partner. A group of three is okay. A group of three is okay. With this new partner, I'll tell you in a moment what you're going to do with your new partner. But before I do, I want to mention what we were doing in the last exercise. It turns out that we end up forming a bond if we are able to share something with our partner and we feel like it is accepted. If we feel like it is judged, then we don't form a bond. But if we tell our partner something about ourselves and we feel like it's accepted, there's a bond. And the bond goes both ways. If I reveal something about myself to someone and I feel like they accept it, I feel connected to them, as well as them feeling connected to me. It's nice to have it go both ways so that we can feel balanced. But I call that sharing. Succeed, fail, create, share. Raise your hand if when you were talking to your partner, you guys found that you had really similar play histories. Yeah. How did that feel to have that in common? It's a nice connection. Humans are really good at connecting with people who have similarities. People who are masters at networking are really good at finding things in common. We're from the same region, or we've lived in the same place, or we are fans of the same sports team, or we wear the same shoes, or we played the same game when we were a kid. People who are masters. Now, raise your hand if you and your partner had very different play histories. Yeah, how was that? It's fascinating, isn't it? I think the people who are at the next level at being able to connect in a social networking situation, connect over the differences. They're able to connect. When we connect over differences, we grow even more. Creative teams have to be diverse. If we just form teams based on people that are similar to us, our creative solutions won't be as rich. This is something that we know. Studies have been proving this over and over again, and we know it for a fact at the D School, that the more diverse the teams, the better the solutions. So finding differences gets very exciting for creative collaborators. Be curious and interested in the differences, because those give us more opportunities. Okay, you have a new partner or partners. Here's a new activity. We're gonna run a bunch of these together. We're gonna play with the idea of accepting offers. I'm gonna have you with your partner. You are gonna generate the world's worst run-on sentence. You're gonna compose a sentence together, and it's gonna go on and on until I ring the bell. But you're gonna improvise the sentence by going back and forth one word at a time. So neither of you know what you're gonna be talking about. You're gonna discover it as you go. And I wonder, is there someone who would be willing to demonstrate this with me up on stage? Someone we have not played. Would you come up, please? Come up. Remind me your name. It's Slava. Come on up, Slava. Give him a hand. Slava is willing to demonstrate. So we'll use the microphone just so that it also can get recorded. We're not going to try and do a good job. We're going to shoot for average. All right? We'll just go back and forth. If you accidentally say two words, no big deal. And we'll go until I say stop. It'll go a little bit longer than it feels comfortable, okay? Just a little bit. Do you want to say the first word, or do you want me to?
Yeah.
Me or you?
You.
Okay. When?
Shrimp.
Swim?
Along?
They?
River?
It?
Wonders?
What?
Goose, like duck.
Oh. Will
sweat
under
my knees. My
knees
on top
of
empire
state
burger
until
we
have
this
under.
Christmas
tree. Okay, good. We'll stop right there. Good. Very nice. Thank you. Excellent. So what did you notice watching us play this game? There's not a right answer. What did anyone call out? What did you notice?
It's a little absurdity, you didn't say.
There's some absurdity. Your goal in this game is not to be clever or interesting necessarily. Your goal is to say the next word and see if you can build a sentence. We're improvising, but you don't have to say a good word. Say the next word. Sometimes it'll make sense and sometimes it won't. That's okay. No big deal. Sometimes when we play this game, we work our way into a grammatical corner, a dead end, and there's no way out. What do we do if we get stuck in this game? You could say, and. I would also say, you could just throw your hands in the air and say, ta-da, and then start over. It's no big deal. See what happens. See what happens if you try to build a sentence by listening to what your partner says and saying the next word. And by the way, you can do it in whatever language you agree to do it in. So make sure you're both are doing the same language. But go ahead, in English, Ukrainian, whatever you want to do. Ready, begin. All right, good. Stop there. How did that go? You got some, there were parts of it where it made sense? Yeah? That's all we're shooting for. Let me ask, I have a couple questions. That was a practice round, by the way. Here's a couple questions. One, was there ever a moment where your partner said a word that you thought they were going to say? Yeah. Isn't that fun? It's one of my favorite parts of creative collaboration is when you and your partner are on the exact same page. It's like you're thinking the same thoughts together. I love that. Did anyone have the experience where your partner said a word you had no idea was coming? Yes. That is my other favorite part of creative collaboration, because now you're on different pages and you have a whole book. There's lots more material. Think about this. If your partner said a word that you had no idea they were going to say, you probably responded with a word they had no idea you were going to say. And in an instant, you were in brand new territory. I would argue that it's possible that in this room just now, there were dozens of sentences that have never been spoken before in human history. Is that possible? Yeah. Ta-da! That's remarkable. This simple game, this simple rule, is creating brand new material. Now, sometimes we use this as a creative idea-generating technique. We say, oh, yesterday we did a workshop right here in this room with some of the folks from Zeo Alliance and the Zeo Labs. And we said, here's your task. You're going to create a brand new restaurant concept. But the way you're going to do it is you're going to do a word-at-a-time sentence around the team. And then they come up with random things on the sentence, and then we go back into talking about it normally to explain what we came up with. Some of this work is have a creative spark and then spend all of your energy explaining or justifying how that would work. We don't need much creativity, just a little tiny bit, and then the rest of our work is making sense of it. Okay, you played with your partner, you've got a practice round. Now I'm going to give you the pro tips. This is how to be an expert at this game. I'm going to give you two tips. The first tip is very simple. Go faster. I'm not saying do it better. I'm saying do it faster. Sometimes people will watch improvisers up on stage doing an improvised show, and they'll come up to the improvisers afterwards. I see this all the time. And they say, wow, that was amazing. I could never do that. I can't think that fast. The dirty secret about improvisation is that they are not thinking fast. They are going fast so that they don't have time to think. Thinking is judging and critiquing and evaluating and selecting the best idea. No time. I don't want the best idea. I want the next idea. So dare to be obvious and allow yourself to go double speed. If you mess up, ta-da, start over, no big deal. Okay, that's the first tip. Here's the second tip. This is about your mindset. This is the way I want you to think about this game. Your skill at the word at a time, run-on sentence game is average. You're fine. You're nothing special. You've played this before. You know how it goes. You're okay. You have nothing to prove. You're a normal, run-of-the-mill, average player. Your partner is a genius. They're one of the best there's ever been. They are a once-in-a-generation, word-at-a-time sentence player. And you, it's like you've won some prize, and the gift that you get is to get to play this game with them for a minute. It's a great honor. You get to play with a master. And they are so good that the words that they say will pop the perfect word into your head. You don't have to think, because you're just going to go where they take you. Go double speed. Your partner's a genius. Ready, go. Give your partner a high five and thank them for playing with you. Great. Well, have a seat. Have a seat. I'm coming towards the end of the amount of time that I have to spend with you, but I want to make sure to give a chance for some dialogue, for some Q&A, for thoughts and reflections and questions. I love that we keep spilling coffee on this perfect floor that is easy to wipe up and clean. Ta-da, terrific. When we do this work, we have to get messy. It has to be okay to fail. It has to be okay to make mistakes. I actually believe that part of my purpose in the world is to be where I am, to be at Stanford, to have the opportunities to work with executives and teams and travel around in different countries and teach people to shoot for average and fail cheerfully. I think that may be my purpose in life, because I know that when I work with high achievers, with people who are trying to do great things, they put a lot of pressure on themselves. They can be successful, but it can also have a cost. And that pressure sometimes limits their ability to be creative, their ability to take risks, their ability to try new things. And sometimes it hurts their ability to be creative and inventive and imaginative. And when I teach my students on the first day, I say, shoot for average and fail cheerfully. It's as if I can see their armor start to crack. It's as if there are defenses that they have that are breaking open, and they start to emerge as themselves. And I think that's a beautiful thing. And part of it is just about giving yourself permission, creating a culture where we're allowed to take risks and make mistakes as long as we learn and grow from them. I think that's part of the goal. So what comments or questions or thoughts do you guys have? Anything that you want to share that was sparked from these games or these thoughts or these exercises? And everyone has a question, raise your hand and we'll run a microphone over to you and you can share it. A comment, a thought, a question, or even a sarcastic remark, whatever you've got. Any hands? There's a couple. Here's one up front. Mm-hmm.
So how can we make money out of it?
It wasn't the purpose. When I first started doing this, the idea of making money wasn't the goal. And I am finding that the world is very, very ripe right now for new ideas. Now, I'm talking at a meta level. I make my money by teaching these ideas and talking about them in front of groups. But I used to have to sneak these ideas into organizations, and now I find that they're asking for them. I work for companies like, you've probably heard of some of them, like Google, Uber, LinkedIn, no, none of these, Cisco. These are the companies that are saying, we need some fresh ideas. We know that the world is changing too fast. And if we keep doing what we're doing, we'll get passed by. And so we need to be agile and resilient. We need to be resourceful. We need to respond to market conditions much faster. And so the skills of design thinking, of being able to iterate on your ideas right away, being able to pay attention to your users, to your customers and your clients, and what their needs are, and meet their needs, is the only way to be successful. Early on when I was doing, I've been teaching this kind of thing for about 30 years. Early on, I was teaching sales skills. It's the same thing. You're paying attention to your customer, you're listening to what they need, and you're forming relationships with them. Are there any salespeople in the room? Yeah. This was an amazing concept. It was kind of a revolution back then. If you know your customer and what they need, and you provide the right solution for them, what happens? You give them the right solution, what happens? You make a sale. You get it, right? If you co-create a solution with your client, with your customer, what do you get? You get a relationship. You get a lifelong set of sales. If you just give them what they need, you have a sale and it's a transaction. But if you form a relationship, then you will weather any dips in the market. So this is something, in a sense, I think these skills are essential to making money, but it's not necessarily the quick money. I can't tell you how to make $1 billion. I see it happen here and there once in a while. But you know, you probably have better success if you trained to be a football star and joined a major team. I think that these skills will be successful in every market, in every condition. Thank you for the question. What other questions? We have another couple, one here, one there, and one there. We'll get the microphone coming around.
Thanks. So it sounds like this treasure chest and this creativity is like a great thing.
Yes.
And it looks like it's like very positive for everyone.
Yes.
So why is it locked so often?
Yeah, I think it's locked. I think that it's fear. I think it's ego. I think that we feel like there's a lot of judgment about our treasure chest. And if I pull something out of the treasure chest and it's not beautiful, then that means I'm not beautiful. Something, this is still in the metaphor. If I come up with a creative idea, people go, ooh. Are you that kind of person? And so I feel like I get judged. The people that are good at this, they let go of their own ego. It's not about me. I didn't say this, but this is the trick to unlocking your treasure chest. Don't bother. Unlock someone else's treasure chest, and they'll unlock yours. Unlock someone else's. It's easier to unlock someone else's, to spark their creative ideas, than it is to unlock your own. I don't know if that helps you. I also think that the dragon is fear, it's shame, and we probably need the dragon. If we are totally uninhibited, we probably can't live with other people. We probably can't follow the rules of civil society. So we need the dragon to keep us honest, but we sometimes we don't need her hovering over us all the time. And that's why I say we want to distract the dragon. Yeah. What else? There's another question here, and then we have one in the very front.
Hi, Lynn.
Hi.
My name is Oleg, and my question is, what's your favorite thing in design thinking?
You ask that question, and I think about each phase and what I love about each phase. There's a really, the central shift from trying to be creative and interesting to trying to help someone else, I think is the most empowering part of the whole process. The part of design thinking that I find to be really exciting and new is the rapid prototyping. The idea that you get an idea and you don't think through what are all the possibilities, you just make it and try it. Don't bother, we can talk about things all we want, It's actually doing it that makes a difference. So that's the part that when I think about design thinking and I think warm feelings about it, it's about folding tinfoil and popsicle sticks and making something to test it out. Thank you for the question. Yeah, here's a running here and then right here. Yeah.
First of all, I want to appreciate you for being with us here and sharing your ideas. Basically, I'm really fond of the creative thinking, and it's really important you're here for us, because our education system basically based on this measurement and judging.
Yes.
So basically for us, it's really important. Yeah. I don't know. For me.
Yes.
I'm not good.
Yes.
Yes. It's in our post-Soviet society, basically. Yeah. And the question is, I believe that everything we can change in our behavior starts from the habit.
Yeah.
And the habit built by routine.
Yes.
So could you please advise us a routine you have, or you advise or teach to have a creative confidence as a habit in our work?
Good, yes. Thank you. All right. It's interesting. I think there's a lot of possibilities in that question. One of the things that I know David and Tom talk about in their book is to do creative experiments. You personally, if you want to live a more creative life, you don't have to do it all at once. Try little small things. You don't have to change your entire work or switch careers in order to start bringing in design thinking and creative confidence. Try little experiments. If you work for a company that has a lot of requirements and you want to bring design thinking into that company, and your boss gives you an assignment, the advice is not to don't do the assignment and do something else instead. The advice is actually to do double deliver, where you do the assignment, but you also do a creative design thinking version of it and present both as a product, and maybe see if that gives you more opportunities. Maybe your boss or your clients will say, oh, that was interesting, can we try a little bit more of that? Personally, in my own life, there's a lot of recommendations in this book, in Improv Wisdom. And this book is really about how to do the daily practices that help you lead a more improvised life. And one of the things that Patricia Ryan Madsen suggests is walk a new way. In your daily routine, you might walk a certain path or drive a certain path. Change your path. Walk a new way and notice new things. And I know personally, my habit is to try and break my routines. So whenever I have a routine, if I notice, oh, I always walk this path, or I always get, you know, a coffee here before I go there, then I try to break my routines. And when you break your routines, you notice the world in a different way. Here's another quick exercise. This is something that you can all do right now. Close your eyes. Everyone, close your eyes. Close your eyes. And I'm going to give you an attention quiz. We've all been sitting in this room for a couple of hours now. I'm going to ask you some questions about the room. Don't open your eyes to peek. I'm going to see if you've been noticing some of these details. The first thing I want you to question I want you to answer is, there are some cameras in the room. How many cameras? I'll say, keep it silent. Answer all of these questions silently in your head, and then you'll open your eyes and see if you were right. Okay, how many cameras do you think there are? Great. The next question is, what is the color of the floor, and what is the color of the columns? There are columns in the room. What color are the columns? Don't say it out loud, but imagine the answer. Another question is, there's something interesting on the walls in this room, something unique that is not on the walls in other rooms. Can you imagine what that is and give as much detail to your picture as you can? When you open your eyes, you'll check and see if that's what you saw, but I want you to picture the interesting wall. There's a drawing on the wall in the front of the room. There's an image of a thing. It's an item. What item is there a drawing of on the wall? Another question that I have is, how many flip charts do I have on the stage? How many flip charts and where are they positioned? What color shoes am I wearing? And then finally, I want you to picture the person or the people next to you, and I want you to imagine exactly their shirt. What is the shirt that the person right next to you is wearing? What color is it? What fabric is it? What style is it? Okay. Open your eyes and see how you did on that quiz. What did you notice? How did you do on the number of cameras, by the way? I heard a lot of people say three. It's not three. There's four video cameras, and then there's one more still camera that's running around as well. I don't know if you guys noticed that. But the image on the wall is of a gun. I don't know if anyone could see that. There's a gun right here. Anyone? How did you do picturing that living wall? Did you remember that there was plants on the wall there? Did you picture the variety of plants, or did you think it was all one kind of plant? How about the color of the columns? No idea. Did anyone get that there was only one flip chart? Did anyone imagine there was another one over on this side? No, I'd say, yeah, good. Good. Ta-da, exactly. Patricia calls this an attention quiz. There's something important about noticing the world around you in order to be creative. We get this sense that we are supposed to invent brand new things. It comes from what's near you. Paying attention is the first step to living a creative life. So working on your careful attention to the world around you. Now, David Kelly and Tom Kelly talk about a source of inspiration for new ideas are things that you notice in the world that aren't working. If you create a bug list, the things that bug you, coffee cups that spill too easily, or things that bug you, it gives you ideas for new possible inventions. So these are some suggestions for how to be more creative in the world as a daily habit. Break routines, pay attention, and notice what the opportunities right here around you are. Good. Time for one more question or comment. Yes.
How do you know where to stop in this creative process? Yes. And being an adult and go on one idea. Because, like, talking from my personal experience, when you are in this creative flow, you are overflown with these compelling ideas, and you even try them, maybe you test and try them.
Yes.
But then you have one more great idea, genius idea, and you start that one, and it's like the endless loop of trying, but they're not going.
You've brought up a wonderful point. Sometimes people talk about how do you start, and one of the things that Patricia Ryan Madsen says is start anywhere. Start anywhere. But when do you end? In the design thinking process, we're always iterating on our ideas. We're never quite done. We're always in beta. And so that can be very challenging. The trick is this. If you find yourself stuck in the idea generating mode, it's time to try something. In a sense, we're never done. At the D School at Stanford, we started 12 years ago in trailers on the edge of campus. And we lived in the trailers for about a year, and then we were offered a spot in a new building. We were able to take over the third floor. So we threw out all our furniture and moved to the third floor of Sweet Hall. And we were there for a year, and they said, we have a new building that you can move into now. And we threw out all our furniture, and we moved into a new building. And every time we moved, we got a chance to start over and iterate. And that's, we're never done. The world is always going to be different than it was yesterday, and we'll always constantly have to adapt. I mean, humans, we're still evolving as a species. And so we're never quite done. But if you find that you're stuck, it's time to go. That's my only advice. We're never really done. But that's not an excuse to not move forward. Are there any other thoughts or comments or questions before I wrap up? Yes.
Thank you very much. My name is Alla, and I want to ask you about skills. What skills, what kind of skills, how much, can help us faster to unlock our treasure, creative treasure?
Yeah, great. Thank you for asking that. I really do feel that that these are the skills that we need to learn how to make rapid connections with people. We need to learn how to let go of our own ego and support other people. So sometimes one of the mantras that we have, one of the slogans that we say is, your job is not to look good, it's to make other people look good. And I think that's an amazing skill that we're not teaching that so commonly. Making other people look good, supporting their ideas and inspiring them. I also think that there's the skill of saying yes, of accepting offers, of saying yes and, is a very important one that we train people to do it accepting other people's ideas and offers. But if you really do it, what we're hoping that you'll learn how to do is to accept your own ideas. We are blocking our own ideas all the time. It's like there's a little, Keith Johnstone calls it a watcher at the gates. There's a guard who's sitting in your mind who's saying, no, 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 not that idea. Don't say that. Don't do that. Don't even think that.
Not now, or maybe after some days or months or years.
Yeah. And sometimes we don't even notice. They shut the ideas right away. But if you play these games, if you explore and you develop your imagination, you give yourself permission to go past that watcher. You give yourself to say yes and to your own ideas. And then the world becomes unlocked. When you were a kid, the colors used to be brighter. The world was magic. Inanimate objects had personalities. You had relationships with them. As you got older, that quieted down. Things looked a little bit duller, a little bit grayer. Playing these games makes the world magic again. Notice the possibilities in everything. That's my advice.
Thank you very much.
I'm going to have one more comment or question from back here, and then I want to wrap up, because I also want to give you guys a chance to connect more with each other. And remember, this is the opportunity that you have here today, is to find each other and find the potential future partners or colleagues or friends or champions in your creative endeavors. So yes, sir.
Hi. So I'm curious, when you're learning playing piano,
yeah,
you first should master some techniques, and then you could do improvisation.
Yeah.
It's almost impossible to do good improvisation when you're like first year. When it comes to the creative thinking, is it the same way or it's different? And then what we should master before, or we should not?
I feel like the people that I work with have already mastered their domains and they're ready for improvisation. When I work with very young groups, they're already masters at improvisation. And so I'm not teaching them how to be creative. When I work with kids, I'm teaching them that it's okay to be creative. And hopefully, as they grow up, they'll remember that. But in my experience, I've never met someone who wasn't ready to learn about improvisation. So I recognize what you're saying about the skill of having enough skill to be able to play around. But it turns out, I think in these domains, we already do have those skills. And by the way, I mean, think about this. You already are improvising all the time. You don't know what your next line is. You're behaving based on the ever-changing conditions that you experience right now. So we're already experts at improvisation. In many ways, I'm just giving you permission to do it in more contexts. Does that make sense?
Sure. Thank you.
Yeah. Now, I want to leave you with this. This is a quote that Keith Johnstone says. It's in his book, Impro, and I'm going to paraphrase this quote. But this, you might find that this is true when you think about the world. There's two types of people in the world. There are people who habitually say yes to things. They accept ideas. And there are people who habitually say no to things. They block ideas. The people who say yes are rewarded by the adventures that they go on. The people who say no are rewarded by the safety that they attain. For me, I think what that means is that we actually have a choice. And both choices are good. Saying yes or saying no are both good. But you may realize that you're saying no in more places than you need to. So my invitation to you is to go on more adventures. Thank you very much. So please take the opportunity to meet more people, play more games with them, and share what you've talked about with others. Great.